All right, so I'm Ben.
I'm Brandon.
So our project is on a vibratory mass damping system for the Arthur G. Russell Company. Our advisors for the project are Dr. Hamad and Dr. Johnson. They're both kind of co-advising on everything that we've been going over so far. And like I said, the sponsoring company is the Arthur G. Russell Company. So for the problem definition, typical vibratory systems produce unwanted or excess vibratory signals that may propagate to other parts of the machine. So basically, the purpose of this project is to develop a test prototype of a new vibratory mass damping system. The Arthur G. Russell Company provides solutions to automated manufacturing systems and equipment and are well known for their automated parts feeding technology. So basically, on all their machines, they have. Okay. So these vibroblocks provide one directional vibratory actuation to, for example, rails of machines. And on these rails, they're basically tracks that parts flow towards their destination and they can be directionally oriented on. The bad side about these vibroblocks is that they create unwanted vibratory signals that can negatively impact other aspects of the machines. To negate these signals, AGR currently uses large amounts of mass and small isolator paths to dampen the vibrations. However, in recent years, these isolator pads and just large amounts of mass is becoming obsolete. So, like I said, these can create problems for like smaller parts, and so the need for increased accuracy with the broad pick and place operations has warranted research into re research and development for a new system that's capable of supplying enough counter mass and dampen vibrational signals as well as isolating vibrational signals. So on the right side of the screen, we have what one of our samples looks like, and we have the key features of them are all labeled. So in the middle is a mass core, which is basically just a specific profile of a carbon steel core. On the outside is an aluminum Matex housing, which we'll get into that more in the next coming slides. And in black around all the cores is a material called sorbithane, which is a viscoelastic material, which is basically the focus of our project. Okay. So moving on to the design constraints, the geometric constraints we're given were that whatever samples that we end up using, they have to be compatible with these like aluminum end caps that tooling will be mounted to. For the material constraints, we were asked to use these Matex extrusions as the housing for the system. We were also used or asked to use sorbithane as the damping material. And like I said, this sorbithane is a viscoelastic material that's known to have excellent damping characteristics. And to ensure that the new system we're developing still retains the correct counterweight, it's been requested that the project team uses carbon steel as a core of the damping system. As for the vibratory constraints, the natural frequency of the system must be greater than 120 hertz. The system has to dampen within the range of 0 to 120 hertz. The system must withstand constant vibratory actuation. And since we're trying to build off a system that's generally too heavy as things have become more complex, this one needs to have a reduction of weight in comparison to what's currently being used. So for the target users, we have AGR research and development engineers. For the foreseeable future, the sole users of the product will be the research and development engineers, as well as employees in the mock-up department at AGR. After there's a guarantee that the new system is durable enough to be a production product, it very well can be sold as a new way to dampen AGR machines. In the immediate future, the system will be used with a new vibratory feeding system, which currently is being designed by Olin School of Engineering. AGR, similar to what they're doing with our group at CCSU, has provided a different project to students at Olin. The main idea is that the combined system can represent where the future's he or sorry, where the company's heading in the future with regards to new technology and products. In the figure above, this is provided from the Olin project. This is basically like a sketch of their system, but what we're working on is blue, the suspended mass bar. I kind of just put this figure here to give you an idea of like how our system is being mounted into the Olin system, like in terms of application. So it'll be mounted in a similar fashion. And their table we bolt onto the faces of the mask cores. And when I say the face of the mask cores, I go back, is the what's the orange arrow was pointing to on this slide. So for previous iterations, figure four, this is what a typical rail setup looks like with AGR. Many of their machines incorporate some kind of system like this. So prior to exploring a new vibratory damping system, and this is still currently in use with old and new machines, Like I said, the AJARs only used isolator pads and large amounts of mass to dampen the systems. The isolator pads are located on the bottom of the systems, which the green arrows are pointing to them. And large amounts of mass have been used to dampen the vibrational signals. And kind of underneath, it's hard to see, but it's hanging underneath. It's just a block of carbon steel, which is used to dampen the system. So our system is going to be building off of this and improving what they're currently using. So we're going to be keeping the idea in mind of having to keep the mass, and we're going to try to add a new idea to it with the use of a viscoelastic material. So for the literature survey, this was kind of difficult to find something that's similar for this project and its application specifically to vibratory parts feeding technology. Combining mass and viscoelastic material has not been used in this industry before. As previously mentioned, the previous iterations, mass has been coupled with isolator pads to dampen and isolate the vibrations. The two components have not been combined into one standalone system before. However, the sorbithane has been used in other industries as vibration damping material and showed a large amount of success. And that's why that's kind of like the core material for what we're going for with this. The most similar application I was able to find was through a literature search, and they use sorbithane to absorb vibrations actuated by in a 4D movie theater. So this 4D movie theater uses a device that transmits electrical signals into mechanical motion, and it's called a butt kicker, which is on the right side of the screen. So a butt kicker uses a voice coil technology coupled with a moving mass suspended in a magnetic field. This moving mass generates linear momentum, which helps to increase vibrational output of the system. In most systems, there's only a piston and a coil moving, which does not generate a large vibrational signal. So basically, the article showed that in comparison with four other viscoelastic materials, that the sorbithane was the most effective material at damping the vibrations. In this application, though, the sorbithane was used as a pad beneath the butt kicker. So the paper did note that after conducting the test, the sorbithane exhibited the smallest amount of vibrational signals transmitted to the surrounding area. But this is hard to compare to our application because per sorbithane, they've never had a constrained application of their product before, which is why we're having to conduct all these tests and we're not able to use their supplied data on the material. So team members, in previous 3 years, I've had three different internships, mostly drafting and designing components. I've designed all from work holding fixtures ranging from rotors for GE jet engines to fixturing for Colt firearm manufacturing of guns. In my current internship, I've been working on designing components for new vibratory feeding equipment. Here, I've had the chance to manufacture parts using 3D printers, lathes, mills, shears. My background in vibratory feeding and my 3 years of experience with drafting and designing, I'd say, are some of my biggest strengths. And as for my weaknesses, everything I know about vibratory feeding has been self-taught on the job, and I definitely feel like a more formal education on the topic would help fill in the holes of understanding some core concepts like dynamic properties. And I mean dynamic properties, I mean like loss, tangent, dynamic, Young modulus, which is some of the things I'm having to look into now. And I also have no previous experience modeling a dynamic system, which is one of the goals that we have.
And so some of my strengths, I pride myself on my communication ability. I have a strong background in mathematics, as most engineers. I have the ability to perform analytics on a large amount of data, so large data sets. I have a past internship in data automation and analytics. Is that an accounting firm? So not necessarily engineering experience, but when it comes to the analysis of data, I definitely have a background in that area. I also am currently in modeling dynamic systems, so that kind of fills in the holes with one of Ben's weaknesses. My main weakness would be a lack of experience in the engineering field. So I have no industry experience with manufacturing. The only CAD software I've used has been at Central, ETM 260, and no practical applications in engineering per se.
All right. So for remaining tasks, I broke them up into two groups, analysis and manufacturing. So for analysis, what we have left is discuss the exact input for the damping system with the Olin team. So right now we're working in a range of 0 to 120 hertz, but we know that the system can react completely differently at 100 hertz as it might to 30 hertz. So getting this information from them will help us narrow the range and hopefully produce a more fine-tuned system. Also, we need to figure out the way of the tooling that's being mounted on top of the system. This, again, will help us narrow down things like spring constants and what range to do our calculations in. We're also hoping to model a system in MATLAB. Brandon, if you want to touch on that.
Yeah, so far, Ben and alongside the team from Olin, we've been able to get experimentally determined spring constants as well as damping constants. And alongside the mass that we know is going to be on the rail, I'm hoping I can use all three of these factors to get an accurate simulation in MATLAB of this system, seeing as testing from here on out is going to be limited, if any can be done at all, then our best option right now is to get it modeled in MATLAB. So currently I have a couple sketches drawn up and a little bit of code written. It's a little tough to get going because this exact application has not been done in my class yet, but hopefully I'm looking to collaborate with Dr. Engelfried on this as well, see if I can get a more accurate model going forward.
All right. And then for the manufacturing tasks, which in theory all the analysis tasks should be completed, but if the MATLAB model isn't done, we can still move forward with it. But we need to, after we find out what all the inputs are going to be, me and Brandon are going to make a presentation to the management AGR and try to provide conclusions on what we think is going to be the best option. And what we'll be selecting will be the steel core dimensions. So that's basically going to be how thick the sorbethane is going to be within that Matex housing, as well as the durometer, the sorbethane. From there, the company, well, they already have the 4 foot section of the Matex extrusion. They're going to have to try to match whatever steel core profile we have with a manufactured one. So the idea for that is because they're pretty unique looking profiles. The idea is to take four foot sections of round stock, and they'll be joined together somehow by or onto a section of bar stock. Either that's going to be welded or they're going to be pressed on. And the idea is this manufacturing task will take about 5 weeks. So things that we've gotten done, two of the biggest things, we'll start with the spring constants that we got tested. So we were able to test all 12 samples at Connecticut Spring and Stamp in Farmington. We initially sent over a testing scope to them to verify if they had the equipment needed to perform the test, and upon confirmation, we were able to set up a date. We used a Larson System Star 11 to conduct all the tests, where a 1,000-pound load cell was used to test the samples. It was recommended by a representative there that we work in the first 20% range of the load cell. So, two pictures above, sorry, four. Figure 6.1 and 6.2 show how we tested the samples applying the force to the face of the mass cores, and underneath the samples, we had a hollow Matex extrusion to allow for travel of the carbon steel cores. And on the right side is how we tested it in the other axial direction. And for this, we had to use a manufactured U-clamp bracket. This just gave us an application or point to apply the force. And the whole process took about 2 hours. And for figure 6.1 and 6.2, we did 4 pound increments for a range of 0 to 20 pounds, and the 0.2 tests on the right side of the screen, we did a range of 0 to 55 pounds. And we picked this range for the samples because we assumed that they'll experience a similar load and application. So these were the results that I managed to plot out for them. After viewing the results, it was determined that the samples with the higher durometer, as well as a gap or smaller gap of sorbethane, proved to be the stiffest of the tested samples. So, reviewing the 0.1 tests on the right side, or sorry, the left side, where the force was applied to the face of the mass core, and an overall larger displacement was observed, which was expected because there was room for the cores to travel, where this resulted in lower spring rates. Let's see. Oh, yeah. Most of the spring rates were all linear, with an R squared value of calculated average of 0.99, where there was an outlier of 0.96 for the 40B.1 test. And in the other tests for the 0.2 were force applied to the U-shaped bracket. Like I said, the mass cores didn't have room to travel because of the constrained environment of the core, which this constrained environment is why we have to collect or find all of our own data for this and can't use this data from sorbethane. But the spring constants range from 4,912 pounds per inch to 14,500 pounds per inch. This behavior and this loading was not linear. As a result, it was recommended that we find the range of force that the samples will experience in application and use the spring constant in that range. One of the more interesting tests we did was a vibratory decay test. And let's see if this will work. All right, so that's a little clip of how we tested every single one of these samples. This was done at AGR. So vibratory decay is essential to the characteristics of the samples we're testing. To test the samples, a pendulum was constructed out of small Matex rails. Additional components, such as the lever of the pendulum, was manufactured out of sheet metal. The point of impact of the pendulum was a small, or sorry, it was a soft mallet face stacked onto 4 pounds of mass. Attached to the face of each core was a flat hex nut, and on the other side of the mask core is an accelerometer, which is bolted to the face of the mask core. The accelerometer is connected to an oscilloscope, which is seen in figure 12, which provide live feed outputs of the accelerometer data. So, interesting little point, initial strikes of the pendulum consist of an acorn nut contacting a flat hex nut, and these results result in a large amount of noise generated due to the metal-on-metal impact. And to help filter out the noise, we ended up using the face of a soft mallet, and by using this, we were able to filter out all the noise. And to encourage repeatability, the samples were located relative to the base of the pendulum stand, and all the samples were clamped to a cast iron table. So the whole testing process took about 6 hours to complete. And so I have a total of about 12 different plots, or actually 24, but I put up two here, comparison plot. So the vibratory decay test revealed that the decay of the signals were more dependent on the geometry of the core rather than the durometer of the sorbithane. So figure 13 compares the results from the vibratory decay test for the four different profiles of the 30 durometer. Using a ratio of the amplitudes of two peaks, we're able to find the damping factors of each sample. So figure 14 compares the calculated damping factors of all the samples we did. And it can be seen that the C and D profiles have the largest damping factors. And for reference, profile A had a gap of sorbithane of 1/4 inch, and profile C had a gap of sorbithane of about 1/8 inch, so about a 2-to-1 ratio. And it was determined that the inversely proportionate ratio between the corresponding damping factors of the two profiles, so 1,200 pounds per second to 2,300 pounds per second. And the most exciting result of this test, and probably the whole project thus far, was that most of the vibratory input was damped by 0.001 of a second, and current AGR machines experience vibratory input of 60 hertz, or one cycle every 0.16 of a second. And this means that every time a new cycle begins, in theory, in application, the system will be at rest as opposed to always in motion. And so processing all the data took about 8 hours. So here's our Gantt chart. The remainder of the semester consists of hopefully retesting samples at AGR. However, there's recently put in no visitor policy, so because of the coronavirus, but they're hoping to test the samples for us and forward us the results from it. But the plan was to hopefully have more than two complete cycles and maybe get a third or fourth on, just to compare the ratio between the first and second peak to the third and the fourth, like I did in the previous test. And furthermore, it's planned that MATLAB model will be completed by the end of the semester, like Brandon talked about earlier. And we were planning on verifying the MATLAB model results by using an accelerometer, testing it live on a rail, and hopefully having an input going into the samples being designated from a vibro block, and accelerometer will be placed on one of the cores to measure the output. And then hopefully we can compare an input and output to a MATLAB model. I just also knew that the CCSU team has to collaborate with the Olin team, which is what we talked about earlier. The focus of the CCSU project, the vibratory damping system, will be coupled with the vibratory feeder from Olin's team. The CCSU team's damp mass bar will be used to dampen the Olin team's feeder. And once we have all this data, hopefully we'll be able to make a final recommendation to AGR for the manufacturing of the prototype. All right, so thus far, the project's been moving according to the initially planned schedule. However, the developments from the coronavirus have slowed down communications between AGR, the CCSU team, and the Olin team. Most of the remaining tasks have not had much progress on them because of this. It's still planned that the CCSU group will meet over Microsoft Teams to discuss the vibratory inputs with the Olin group. And this will, of course, give us a chance to present everything we've had, or everything we've discovered so far about the project, to everybody involved. More importantly, we've been able to get some solid data from the spring constants testing, the vibratory decay tests. As previously mentioned, the vibratory decay test yielded that our vibratory input was damped by 0.001 of a second, which is quicker than the actual rate of application from vibratory inputs at 60 hertz. These results have been very encouraging to AGR and the project group in determining how effective this system really will be. And to make sure that we finish everything on time, we determined that it would be best to have constant communication between the three parties involved. This ensures that everyone is involved, consistently being updated, and work is being completed as needed. Communications, in my opinion, will be vital for selecting the configuration that will be constructing the full-scale prototype. And just to summarize, I put on the cores that we'll be selecting from in figure 16 and 17. So we had core D on the left side, which is supposed to resemble bar stock in the middle and round stock on the sides. And then core A, core B, and core C, where it just varies the gap between all three of them.